Someone's cursing, my lord. Late night lunch. Someone's puffling, my lord. Late night lunch. Someone's growing, my lord. Late night lunch. Oh lord, late night lunch.
This is a post-watershed production.
A warm and sticky welcome to the womb of post-historical apathy. Stewing in my own juices is Aaron Bliss, and if you thought switching from first to third person mid-sentence was outrageous, wait till you meet my co-conspirator, the always aroused Michael Large.
Always aroused. Thank you very much.
Welcome to another edition of Late Night Large. And today's show is going to be about transgression. Call it sin, crime, misdeeds, delinquency, ill-doing, immorality, depravity, ungodliness, call it what you will. We're going to discuss transgression in all its unholy glory. We decided to phrase this in the context of the seven deadly sins. So without further ado, here's the track that represents our first sin we're going to discuss, which is gluttony.
The following section has been removed due to copyright infringement. Sorry about that. Fight the power.
Mike, give us your opening thoughts on that sin. Is it something you feel like you're guilty of?
Not quite sure what you're trying to say there.
I think you're well aware of what I'm trying to say.
Be careful, all right? These are onions, but they make you cry. No, I'm not. Thank you very much. Ah, no. What's my opinion on gluttony? It's a sin, don't do it.
Well, the definition of gluttony is generally habitual eating or drinking to excess. So we could probably...
Drinking to excess?
Yeah, we could probably include consumption of narcotics or alcohol.
In that case, sorry about me. I'm pretty gluttonous.
Would you say that gluttony is de rigueur these days? As
yes.
Well, I mean, you just look at our ridiculously unregulated food industry, where, you know, I'm not sure if trans fats have been phased out now, but obviously saturated fats are a big concern, addictive components in junk food, and obviously the massive obesity epidemic that's spreading across the country.
The world. Wow.
I don't think Africa's really suffering from it, but...
You know what I mean.
Yeah. Gluttony, Mike. Do you think it's the en vogue sin of the modern day?
Yes.
More so than the other sins that are kind of, you know, cyclical maybe as well.
Well, no, I don't know if I'd say more so than all the... It's one that's easy to point out and things, isn't it?
Okay, well, let me put this to you. Some people might say that gluttony is a pretty harmless sin because, for instance, some people might argue that it only affects the person who is a glutton, as opposed to other sins which impinge on other people.
I disagree with that.
Go on.
Only affects the person that is a glutton. No. Not at all. I mean, obviously, it depends. It's on the situation. Take someone who is gluttonous with food and their eating habits to a ridiculous point, and they become unhealthy as a result. How does that not affect their family? You know, their friends and their family. I mean, so I think anyone that would say it's, you know, it's just.
Or the National Health Service.
Well, yeah. Anyone that would say it just affects that particular person is selfish.
Oh, okay.
And probably gluttonous themselves.
Controversial. See, you could also potentially add things like smoking. Chain smoking, you could argue, is a form of gluttony. Anything done above moderation that's, you know, for personal gratification, you could argue is gluttony.
No, you could, you're right. So yeah, I guess smoking, chain smoking, I guess that could be construed as a gluttonous activity, I guess.
So, okay, just to round this off, where do you rank gluttony? In the seven deadly sins, where would you rank it? Near the top or the bottom? In terms of most serious effect on the person and those around them?
Well, I'm trying to remember the other ones, mate, to be honest. I don't know. Ask me at the end. I'll rate them at the end. There you go.
Okay, we'll have a rank of hell that you condemn the sinners to at the end.
The following section has been removed due to copyright infringement. Sorry about that. Fight the power.
Okay, that was some quality trip hop from Massive Attack with Inertia Creeps, which leads us nicely into Sloth. Right, Mike, any opening thoughts on Sloth as a deadly sin?
No, not really, mate. Can't be bothered.
Very good. Yeah, Sloth, idleness.
I think all things that I'm not going to... Yes, perhaps I can be accused of being guilty of.
I'm also going to throw something in there that it occurred to me that if you divide the left and the right wing thinking into their extremes, Sloth would probably be what the left wing is most characterised to fall into, whereas greed would be what the right wing is characterised as. Anyway, maybe a thought for later. So Sloth, I think I remember reading that it's not so much meant as idleness as being someone not fulfilling their potential. So someone basically being gutless, not reaching for their ambitions, not pulling their weight, basically.
Yeah, again, perhaps some people could accuse me of that. Perhaps I'm not the best person to lecture.
Right, this isn't
other people.
This isn't a persecution.
It sounds like a persecution. No. Perhaps I'm not the best person to lecture other people on the...
Do you think Sloth is the easiest sin to fall into?
Yeah. No. They're all pretty easy.
Would you say apathy could be described as sloth? For instance, well, let me give you an example. Political apathy. So, say, decisions are being made by the state, whichever party's in power. And you get very, very pent up and angry about all these decisions, they're affecting you negatively, but you don't protest in any way or express yourself in any way. You just slump your shoulders and think, I just can't be bothered, and are completely apathetic about it.
Yes.
And the same thing, you know, say for instance you live in a rough neighbourhood and you see bad things happen to people all the time from, I don't know, criminal gangs or whatever, and you don't step in, you don't say anything about it, you stay in the shadows. Is that sloth as well?
I'm not so sure that last example that you... I mean, because, for example, the last example you get... the example you gave, I mean, that's... I'd say there are other reasons why you wouldn't step in or do anything about it, like personal safety. I wouldn't call that sloth.
No, but is the basis of sloth in cowardice? That's what I'm trying to say.
Plagiarism. I'd say a lot, yeah. Not solely, I wouldn't say, but yeah, majority of the time, I think you could base it or bring it back to cowardice. Yeah.
Sorry, I jumped in there. Another thing that came into my mind: plagiarism. Would you class plagiarism as sloth?
Yeah, definitely. Got caught out on that, didn't I?
Oh, you fool.
Yeah, got caught out. I'm not proud of it, so I don't know why I'm laughing. It's not funny. Yeah, A levels, got caught out. Got caught out twice.
Idiot. Okay, well, yeah, now I personally think plagiarism, and you know.
And it, yeah, definitely falls in the sloth.
Certain people would also argue that copyright theft and piracy would be sloth. That's slightly different, but.
Slightly different, but I can see the point.
You can. Yeah, so, like we say, sloth, you know, sometimes it's looked upon as a harmless sin, you know, idleness, people just wasting away on the sofa when they could be out discovering the world. Although, from what we've discussed, you know, there are other things to elements to it. Cowardice, not pursuing your ambition, not reaching to get what you want in life, and obviously plagiarism, you know, sucking the inspiration out of other people. So yeah, sloth, I think, is has more dimensions to it than we thought. Yeah, the next Anyway, the next sin we're going to debate, which the track's coming in for now, with Emily Autumn, with Thank God I'm Pretty, will be pride. I want you to sit back and relax. Relax more than you've ever relaxed before. Perhaps in a comfortable armchair. Just feel yourself sink into the upholstery as if it's a cloud swallowing you. And then gradually close your eyes. Now, piece by piece, let your body go completely limp. Visualize your breath running through you, sucking it in through your mouth and nose, all the way through your head, down into your lungs, rolling over your shoulder and down your arms, escaping out of your fingertips, down through your waist, down through your legs, and again out of your toes. Everything's going limp. You have no weight at all. I want you to visualize yourself becoming an autumn leaf, clinging to the branch and gradually acquiescing to the force of the breeze that takes you away, carries you through the sky, watching the world below you, people moving around, pounding the street, getting to and from their job, finishing their hectic lunch break, people fighting, honking their horns. But none of that matters to you now. The world below is of no consequence because you're just an autumn leaf drifting along on the breeze. You have no weight, no worries, watching everything unfold below you with no concern at all. You are in a deep, deep trance. Everything is white and relaxing. And I want you to listen carefully now. I want you to send all of your money and your nubile daughters to Late Night Large, care of Dennington on Air. Do it now. Which leads us into the next sin we're going to debate, Mike, which is pride, and I'm sure it's a sin that you're well familiar with.
Yeah, well, thank God I'm pretty. I think pride. I mean, sin? Is it?
When we talk about pride, I guess we're talking about vanity, narcissism, but then you also have self-delusion, don't you?
Not personally.
Pride, anyway. I think most people would perceive this. I think the classic example people would perceive is especially a woman who, or a man who believes they are God's gift to the opposite sex.
Yeah.
Which suits you well, to be honest, Mike.
Yeah, because, you know, they're all wrong. Clearly I am.
Okay. A good contemporary context for pride. Cosmetic surgery. The boom. Yeah. In modern cosmetic surgery, do you think? I mean, surely this is down to pride, as I mean, along with gluttony, probably a very contemporary sin. This,
cosmetic surgery. Obviously, that would be pride, but there are different reasons, aren't there? Obviously, there are different reasons behind it.
True.
Like reconstructive surgery.
No, I mean, okay.
You can't count that.
I think you know what I'm talking about.
But then there are different reasons why people do it, aren't there? Even take away, obviously, reconstructive surgery and things. There are some people do genuinely have, like,
I know what you're going to say.
Confidence issues.
I know what you're going to say. Yeah.
And things.
But is that not pride?
Of course it's pride.
Because what I'm trying to say is, we think of pride as, you know, oh, some arrogant so and so who's up their own backside. But what we really mean is, surely pride is taking too much or placing too much importance on how one looks.
Who decides?
If it affects your whole life, you know, you can't leave the house, you can't talk to people or anything because you're so obsessed with perfecting your body or your face, does that not fall into pride?
Yes, it does. But is it then you got to ask yourself, is it a sin? Is it a sin to want to look good? I mean, luckily for me, I was born this good.
There was
a saying that some are born great and some have greatness thrust upon them. I was born great, and if you're lucky, then I will thrust greatness upon you.
There is another saying that anyone who quotes that is a vacuous so and so. But
that's fine, because I don't know what that means.
Clearly very proud of himself. Anything else we can say about pride before we go on to our next sin? I mean, okay, let's talk about it as ego. The power of the ego. I think you could definitely put this on heads of state, you know, dictators, tyrants, despots, prime ministers. Now, surely that's pride. For instance, you know, Kelling backbench rebellion, making very unpopular policy decisions, going into war. You know, I'm going to pull the obvious example of Tony Blair going into the unholy Iraq union with George W. Bush. Was that an obscene example of pride coming to the fore? Would it, his own ego?
I guess that depends on your opinion on it, doesn't it? I mean, your opinion will be different to probably mine and probably half the other people.
I would be very surprised listening. If there's a person listening to this show that thinks the war in Iraq was justified. But
yeah, okay.
What I'm trying to say is, heads of state, politicians, to be honest, anyone in power, surely they suffer from pride, especially when they're making unpopular decisions. Let's say, for instance, I don't know, bankers who are shamelessly pilfering obscene bonuses. When I say shamelessly, to the complete disregard of everyone paying for their mistakes. Surely that's pride again, or are we treading into greed?
Greed. Yes.
Anyway,
greed.
Yes. Greed. Anyway, that's the end of our pride discussion. We're going to move on with our next track, which represents envy.
The following section has been removed due to copyright infringement. Sorry about that. Fight the power.
The morbidly morose master of melancholy, Morrissey, with "We Hate It When Our Friends Become Successful."
Okay, so envy, Aaron. You are probably a good person to get us going on this one.
I had a feeling. What, so if you represent pride, then I supposedly represent envy of your pride. Is that what you're trying to say, Mike?
Yeah.
Anyway.
Not so many words? No, not at all.
No, good. Anyway, envy. Covetousness. You know, the grass is always greener. That's a good way of summing up envy.
Indeed.
Any thoughts, Mike?
I don't suffer from it, so why would I? Why would I envy anyone, any man, anyone else? Why would I, you know? I know what it's like to be envied.
As you can see, well down the path of the pride sinner. Anyway, envy. As I said, grass is always greener, but... On, for instance, we could say grass is always greener, i.e. it leads to the kind of decisions which means that you leave, for instance, a partner who's been very good to you to shack up with someone else, or it leads you to leave the family that you've been with for decades because, you know, you see something fresh and new. These kind of things, would that be based in envy? But a lot of people would say that envy, again, like all sins, I suppose, in moderation, envy fosters ambition.
Which counters sloth.
Yes, it could do. So envy, again, what we're talking about is extremes, aren't we? Can you imagine, I mean, the extremes where people are so bitterly envious of someone they perceive to be far superior to them that it ruins their own life, and potentially, I mean, let's face it, can have fatal consequences. Like, for instance, the obvious is the crime of passion. That's based in envy, isn't it? If someone takes your partner.
Yes,
I mean, that's one classic extreme. Any other thoughts, Mike, on the how envy can affect a person?
Sorry.
What about class envy? Class envy, let's talk about that.
Well,
do you think that that still exists?
Yes. And obviously it does, and there are people that get bitter about it, and there are...
Can I throw in another contemporary concern? Would you say that, again, the modern age has thrown up a new form of envy, and it's not an envy like any that we've known before, because normally an envy is envying someone who has something you wish to have or in a position you wish to be in.
Jealousy, isn't it?
Yeah, this new envy I'm talking about is the, let's say, the stigma of people on welfare. Okay. Mainly driven by the right-wing media.
Something for nothing state.
Yeah, exactly. That's what they coin it as. In other words, it's an envy based on not a desirable situation you want to be in, but an envy in which you feel like you're working to support someone else.
You're hard done by. Yeah, I feel like that sometimes, to be honest. I don't earn very much money, and then the tax man comes along and takes away a lot of it. And then there are people that don't have a job that find themselves with more disposable income than I have.
Do you know anyone personally who does that?
I'm not going to name any names.
Really?
But yes.
Yes. And I'd also like to, just to balance the debate up, would also like to mention people born into wealth and extreme privilege who then potentially give into sloth and other sins because everything's been paid for them. So that's the opposite end of the scale. But yeah, again, a good discussion on envy there. We're going to move on to our next sin again. So here's the next song, representing lust. This is Korn with Adidas.
Get your stinking rat out, it's late night large.
Lust. A favourite topic of mine. No, you're right. Aaron's taking some leave. Lust is, I mean, sin. Yeah, I guess so. Can lead to sinful acts, can't it? Lust. Everyone's opinion's different on it, and mine will probably be different to all of yours. Derives originally from prostitution and things like that as a sin. So, I mean, lust in that form, obviously, is derogatory and not good. Aaron ever fallen foul of the lust sin?
Of course. I mean, let's face it, it's probably the most fun of all the sins. Carnal instinct, whatever you want to call it. I think it's the it's definitely that. I would say it's the, I was going to say the hardest sin to resist, but it's the most obvious sin that's the hardest to resist, is what I meant. I think almost everyone is driven by a desire for people lust. They it's may or may not have
basic animal instinct. It's we're
the desire to reproduce.
We're all wired to be lustful, and I mean, to label it a sin, I mean, I don't.
But from what you're saying, if its origins are in the oldest profession,
yeah,
then
of course
a lot of people see prostitution as a very wrong thing.
I'm not saying I endorse prostitution, but to, you know, lust is, you know, okay, there are varying degrees and ways of expressing lust, aren't there? And yeah, okay, prostitution, not good. Okay, that's pretty standard opinion, one that I also share. But I mean, to label the feelings of lust that we all have through no fault of our own as a sin. That's pretty harsh.
Let's not forget that it wasn't a million years ago when the church condemned masturbation, and in fact, obviously in parts of America still, and other devout fundamentalist areas, masturbation still seen as evil because it's surrendering again to lust.
It depends. Again, yeah, it depends on your beliefs and time. And opinions change on these sins, and the definitions of them, I guess, change as well. They have changed as time goes on, and they will go on to change again in the future, I've no doubt.
Okay, I mean, let's, for instance, just controversial territory, but take it to the extreme version of example of rape. I mean, clearly it's not totally driven, it's obviously related to power, but obviously lust plays a part. I mean, that could be the extreme version of a crime instigated from that particular sin, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you can, okay, yeah, a crime instigated. Okay.
In other words, I mean, for instance, for lust to be a sin,
yes.
Excuse the coughing, by the way. For lust to be a sin, it means you have to surrender to it. Now, if you're finding a sexual partner consensually, and then maybe, I guess, remaining monogamous to that partner or whatever you've agreed, that wouldn't necessarily constitute surrendering to lust.
According to your belief. I mean, we weren't made to be monogamous. We weren't. We're meant to reproduce. We're meant to go around and find as many partners and repopulate. And
do you believe this, listeners? I've got to say that I'm glad we ended it on that, because it's a very controversial and brilliant point that Mike makes. Please tell us if you think that that's a horribly misogynistic comment.
It's not
on the Facebook page. Anyway, we could go on about lust all day, because quite frankly, we all succumb to it time and again. We're going to move on to the next track now, and this is going to go out to every Occupy movement, particularly Occupy London. This represents greed. This is Depeche Mode, and Everything Counts.
The following section has been removed due to copyright infringement. Sorry about that. Fight the power.
Mike, we could obviously talk about this all night, but let's try and keep it short and snappy. We're going to talk about greed. Mike, what do you think of when you think of the sin of greed?
Well, obviously something comes to mind that you've already mentioned in the show. The bankers taking massive bonuses for themselves despite the economy spiralling into crap, and you know that's the first thing that probably springs into most people's head.
Okay, let's unfold the base definition of greed. I would say probably the definition of greed would be amassing far more than you might need at the expense of other people. Is that fair?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's always at the expense of other people, but let's be honest.
What is most of the time,
isn't it?
I can't imagine a situation where it's not at the expense. I mean, for instance,
well, okay, I'm not going to go to the shop, I'm not going to buy one chocolate bar. I'm going to buy 14 chocolate bars.
Mike,
I'm going to sit at home.
That's gluttony.
I'm going to get home, and you know my little brother's going to be there. You know, my mum's brought him round. He says, "Can I have one of those?" I say, "No." You know, that's greed.
That is gluttony, and it is at the expense of someone else. It's okay, Mike.
I suppose it becomes. Yeah, that only becomes.
Now, greed. If let's talk. I mean, let's expand this into the bigger picture. Greed, you know, the obvious. You know, the banking situation is an obvious example of greed. The banking sector have been almost not regulated at all since I don't know, about 1979 onwards. But basically, greed. We all think of the obvious version of greed is the banking situation where people amass more and more money for themselves, and unfortunately we're in a political situation where the wealth of the country is being channeled to the super rich rather than the middle class, which is again a big reason why our economy is just kaput. But it's not just money, is it? It's not people just amassing money at the expense of everyone else. It's amassing other things. And I'd say that the biggest version is the Earth's resources. Now, we live on a planet with, let's face it, I'm afraid there's a finite amount of resources on the planet. The planet is expendable. We can't continue mining materials, cultivating agricultural land, building concrete on top of swathes of green land forever. There's only a finite amount. And for massive corporations and states to go into, say, poorer nations and to, you know, basically purloin their minerals, ores, I mean, you know, you get the ridiculous situation of countries that are so poor they can't feed themselves having to sell their food to wealthy countries just so they can stay afloat. But, I mean, greed, that's what it's all about, isn't it? It's about looking at yourself and your select group of people as opposed to the bigger picture.
Selfish.
Yeah, ideally it's selfishness, but it could also be, you know, looking at yourself as in the people in power. You know, tyrants, dictators, whatever, when they're mistreating their people, I mean, that's greed again, isn't it? Maintaining the status quo, where the status quo means the people at the top get almost everything. A position, let's say, where the top 10% of the population own 80% of the wealth.
Yeah.
It's all based in greed, isn't it?
Well, a lot of places it's worse than that, isn't it?
Yeah. Okay, well, we are kind of running out of time here. So let's merge greed into the final sin, which we're going to end on with a song. But we're just going to, you know, when greed gets too much, as we've seen in the Occupy movements, which let's hope just a harbinger of the protest to come, it could very well lead to our final sin, which is wrath.
You will feel my wrath.
Mike, what does wrath mean to you?
It means don't get in my grill, or or you'll feel my wrath. Well, it's like you say, it can be a consequence of people deciding they've had enough of other people's greed, or it can come as a consequence of any of the other deadly sins.
Especially lust, I'd say, is quite a big one, and envy.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, in a big way. Lust, I mean, that, you know, it's obvious how that can lead to wrath.
So wrath, let's face it, anger is a natural emotion as part of a human, but being a human being.
Yep.
But wrath, I'd imagine, as a sin would be, and again, the ideal characterization of it would be to enact hateful and probably violent retribution, or without even retribution, just violence enacted against another person. Do you think that's what wrath means, or do you think it's even more abstract than that? Is it shouting at someone angrily, insulting someone?
Yeah, I think so.
Bullying someone,
yeah. I think that it all comes under the same umbrella, I think. So, yeah, I'd say that all is, comes under the wrath umbrella.
Right, yeah. To tell you the truth, we've basically run out of time now. Hope you enjoyed this enlightening discussion on the seven deadly sins. We're going to wrap up Late Night Large for tonight. Mike, anything to add before we go?
No.
Yeah. In fact,
try not to, if you can. I know it's hard. Be good people. Live your lives how God would want you to. And don't fall foul of the seven sedley dins, or the deadly sins. Stay away from them as well.
Yes. What we're trying to say is maybe you should enact the seven heavenly virtues instead of diligence, humility, charity, chastity, patience, kindness, and temperance.
Not so much chastity.